Hi dear students, I hope you are enjoying the NAMS YouTube experience. And in the last 2 weeks, because of the lockdown, we have increased the number of teaching videos that we are putting on the YouTube channel. We are trying to put I think one or two videos at least per day, and I want to take this moment to appreciate the teachers who are doing this. And we have also a unique series with us called as the Unplugged, where we are able to put the things together in a patient. In these discussions, we look at how the patient presents to how the lab and the radiology findings fit in. And we also look at the management of the disease. We try to look at all the aspects of the disease in this kind of videos. With me today, we have Dr. Rahul Raji, who is a neurologist. I am a radiologist. And today we'll look at a unique patient together. When I say unique is because this is a kind of patient where you'll see a lot of typical findings, but you will also see a lot of less typical findings and some unusual findings, which will be a learning experience both for the undergraduates and even for the resident doctors who are listening to us today. That even for resident doctors like neurology resident, medicine resident, and definitely radiology residents, this would be a good learning experience. So I want you to focus on how we start looking at a patient from history to clinical examination to lab findings and putting it together. I'll ask Dr. Rahul to present the patient to us.
Hello, everyone. So moving forward with this case. So this is a 34-year-old male with no previous comorbidities, presented to us with headache of 6 days duration, blurring of vision of 3 days duration, and drowsiness of 2 days duration. Moving to the history in detail. So the headache was noticed around 6 days back, around the afternoon. It was a bifrontal dull aching pain. It was a constant pain with only slight relief with analgesics. So patient would take some analgesics, slight relief, but again the pain comes back. So more or less constant pain. And this was associated with multiple episodes of vomiting. And for the past 3 days, he is having intermittent blurring of vision. And also for the past 2 days, he seems excessively drowsy. He is less responsive to the usual conversation, and at times he has irrelevant talk. So let us analyze the history. It is a short duration illness of 6 days duration. Started off with headache, vomiting, and intermittent blurring of vision. So this combination of headache, vomiting and intermittent blurring of vision more likely suggests that the patient is having features of raised intracranial tension. Now, for the past 2 days, the patient was drowsy. Why should drowsiness occur in a patient with raised intracranial tension? Either it could be an indicator of a bihemispheric affection, or it could be due to involvement of the reticular activating system in the brainstem. We're not sure. So with this in mind, let's move forward to the examination. So the patient was drowsy. He was oriented in person, not in time and place. Pulse rate 58 per minute, regular, which means he has bradycardia. Blood pressure is 200 on 120, definitely an evidence of hypertension. And menace reflex was present. Since the patient was drowsy, we were not able to do a proper visual field examination, but menace reflex was present. The fundus showed bilateral disc edema along with flame-shaped hemorrhages, cotton wool spots, and hard exudates. Now, I just want you to think about the history once again. We were thinking that this patient had raised ICT. So yes, we thought in mind this, there could be disc edema. But it's not just disc edema alone. You also had flame-shaped hemorrhages, cotton wool spots, and hard exudates. So additional hypertensive changes were also there in the fundus examination. The pupils were equal and reactive to light. The extraocular movements showed bilateral abduction restriction. Again, probably due to raised ICT. You know that whenever some patient has raised intracranial tension, there can be a lateral rectus palsy, bilateral sixth nerve false localizing sign, and that could be because of which the patient has a bilateral restriction of abduction. Other cranial nerves apparently normal. Why I say apparently is because, you know, we have a drowsy patient, so a full-fledged neurological examination was not possible. Now, we also noticed that the patient was having decreased movement of all limbs. In spite of giving a painful stimulus, he was not moving all limbs very much swiftly. There was paucity of movements of all four limbs. There was bilateral extensor plantar, and the deep tendon reflexes were very much brisk. There is no neck stiffness or any other signs of meningeal irritation. Now, after the history and examination, let us put it together. Short duration illness, 6 days. Raised ICT followed by drowsiness. Examination showed there is bradycardia and hypertension. Disc edema, but remember, not disc edema alone. Disc edema with hypertensive changes and bipyramidal signs. So before we, think of the etiologies, let us visualize what are the likely anatomical structures involved. Yes, there is likely to be a bihemispheric affection. And the brainstem affection, the reticular activating system affection, we are not quite sure, but there is always a possibility of involvement of the brainstem as well as the patient is excessively drowsy, although that can very well occur with a bihemispheric affection. And since there was bipyramidal signs, definitely the bilateral corticospinal tract is also involved. That is why the patient is having extensor plantar and bipyramidal signs. See, considering the etiologies, possible etiologies in this patient. So one possibility is that this could be an ADAM. So because, why ADAM? Because there is multiple axis involvement. So could it be a disseminated lesion? But again, there is no history of a viral infection. So that is less likely, but still it is a possibility. So cerebral venous thrombosis. If it is a cerebral venous thrombosis, we should keep in mind that it's likely that the superficial as well as deep venous system should be involved because we have pyramidal signs also. So if just the superficial venous system is involved, it is very unlikely that the pyramidal tract is going to be involved. So definitely this is likely, if at all it is a cerebral venous thrombosis, it has to be a superficial plus deep venous system involvement. And we saw that the blood pressure is high. Could it be PRESS, that is a posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome, which was previously often given a term like hypertensive encephalopathy, that is a manifestation of a raised blood pressure? Could it be that? PRESS is possible, but again, there is pyramidal tract involvement in this patient, which means, again, that is an odd feature. We're not quite sure. The other differentials we had in mind were, one is an artery of Percheron infarct, that is a vascular event, a stroke. We know that this artery of Percheron is arising, it's a variant. It's a vascular anatomical variant, which arises from the posterior cerebral artery and supplies the midbrain and thalamus. So could it be an artery of Percheron infarct in view of this drowsiness, bipyramidal signs? But again, just think of the history. The total illness duration is 6 days. So there is a progression. So it is a vascular event or a stroke is less likely to progress over these 6 days. Could it be a case of viral encephalitis? Again, there is no fever in this patient. So again, less likely. And could it be due to midline mass lesions, which can very well produce raised intracranial tension? We have that lower in the list. And also when there is multiple intracranial space occupying lesions like a tuberculoma, neurocysticercosis, that can also be a differential. So in this case, we have to put a long list of differentials because it is quite an atypical case. So with this in mind, let us move forward to see the CT findings, the non-contrast CT findings. So Sumer sir will be discussing regarding the non-contrast CT of this patient.
Thank you, Rahul, for an extensive description. And I think you've already given a long list of differential diagnosis. And it's not a straightforward case here because we see a lot of DDs to be ruled out. There are a lot of questions that a radiologist is supposed to answer. So let's look at the first set of images here. This is a non-contrast CT of the brain where we are going from below upwards. And I want you to look at the posterior-most part here, which is the cerebellum. And the first outstanding feature that we are able to pick up in the imaging findings here directly is that the cerebellar foliae appear a lot, much more prominent than what they would do in a normal patient. compare the cerebellar foliar prominence with the cerebral sulci of this patient, you will see that there is out of proportion atrophy here. So there is element of cerebellar atrophy, which was, I think, unsuspected on the clinical details. So, you know, we have to think of causes like maybe things like long-term alcohol intake. You know, Rahul, it would be a good idea if...
Yes, this yes, sir. Actually, you know, this patient is a chronic alcoholic. So it could be the cerebellar atrophy could be because of that. But he has no history of any long-term intake of drugs like phenytoin, which also is commonly known to cause this cerebellar atrophy. But maybe the patient is a chronic alcoholic right from his early 20s. He has been a daily drinker.
So that probably could explain this. But let's see the further imaging. But before we see that, I want you to look at the left-sided posterior temporal region. You can, you know, we are able to start seeing, if we see, we are able to see some hypodensity here, and when you look at the brainstem pons, we can see the midbrain. We are not able to see any abnormality, but in the CT. But I want to remind the listeners that CT is a suboptimal technique for posterior fossa evaluation. So we do not know what the MRI would be able to tell us at that time. But so far on CT, there is some doubtful hypodensity in the pons, but we are not really sure. So far, what we see is cerebellar atrophy predominantly in these images. And if I go above on the higher sections now, we can see now bilaterally symmetrical, we can see areas of hypodensity predominantly involving the white matter in the parieto-occipital region, bilaterally symmetric. Now, when we were looking at the differentials, one of the differentials that Rahul mentioned was PRESS. Now PRESS, and because the patient was hypertensive, in people who have rapid changes in blood pressure because of a faulty autoregulation in the posterior circulation, you may have disruption of blood-brain barrier there, and that can lead to edema. And you can see that this is a predominantly white matter edema. The gray matter appears spared. So you can have vasogenic edema in the parieto-occipital region. This could be PRESS. But when we look at the other differentials that Rahul was talking about, this is much more symmetrical to be a tumor. You know, although it is possible to be a tumor or something like a gliomatosis cerebri, which is more infiltrative kind of a glioma, but this is much more symmetrical to say that. And I think the same would apply to tuberculomas and NCCs. We don't see any focal lesion. We only see edema so far in the CT, but we have not done an MRI. We have not given contrast to say that, but the symmetry seems to point more towards PRESS. Arteriopercutaneous infarction is bilateral, but typically, as Rahul has already mentioned, it supplies bilateral thalami and the midbrain area because of it's a anomalous or it's a variant branch of PCA. So, but we don't see the involvement in thalamus and midbrain here, so we would put them lower down. So the top differentials here for me would be PRESS, and I would still keep cerebral venous thrombosis as one of the possibilities. Venous thrombosis can lead to bilateral symmetrical involvement, that is still possible. But CT has its own limitations when we look at posterior fossa, when you look at brainstem, CT has its own limitations to comment on them. And CT alone, especially when we do a non-contrast CT, there would be limitations in evaluation. So standard of care here would be an MRI, preferably contrast-enhanced MRI, and preferably we should also be looking at MR venogram here. So this would be my advices from my report so far in this imaging evaluation.
Okay, sir. Okay. So, say at the end of the non-contrast CT, what sir actually is saying that its top two differentials, one would be PRESS, and the second would be cerebral venous thrombosis. But for sure, this is not ADAM because these lesions are not suggestive of ADAM also. So this patient was, you know, because one thing was quite sure that the blood pressure was high. So the patient was aggressively treated with antihypertensive. And you know, there was raised intracranial tension also. So patient was given mannitol. And for the headache, analgesics were also given. Now, moving on to the blood investigations of this patient, you can clearly see that this patient was anemic. There was thrombocytopenia also, and the ESR was raised. And among the other investigations, So there was an evidence of a renal injury. That is, the creatinine was 1.8, urea was 35, and the electrolytes and liver function test were normal. Viral markers were negative. Now, moving on to the autoimmune panel, that is, you know, we did an ANA profile. This ANA was positive. The anti-DS DNA was positive and anti-Smith antigen was positive, definitely indicating that this patient is having a connective tissue disease. And we know that Smith and DS DNA are more specific with SLE. So this patient is having SLE. That is also clear. Now, you know, if you remember, one autoimmune disease in a patient, you know, it's always likely that he has a second autoimmune disease, which is why in this patient, the TSH was high and anti-TPO was also high. So probably this patient is having a Hashimoto thyroiditis as well. So far from the blood investigations, we have got an evidence of a connective tissue disease in this patient. You keep in mind this one, that this patient was a male. Commonly, you know, this connective tissue diseases are seen in females. But here we have SLE as well as evidence of Hashimoto thyroiditis. Urine routine examination, it was normal. Even there were no sediments also, because whenever there is a connective tissue disease and subsequent vasculitis, maybe you can see some RBC cast, some proteinuria. But here there was no protein. Even we did a urine protein creatinine ratio that was also normal. So it was just the acute kidney injury that was there in this patient. But again, a 34-year-old male, young, hypertensive. For the workup, we also did to rule out pheochromocytoma. We also did the urine metanephrine as well as normetanephrine, which was normal. The plasma metanephrines were normal. And the renal artery Doppler also was done, which was also normal. So at the end of history, examination, non-contrast CT, and our blood investigation, what is there in our mind? So out of the venous sinus thrombosis and PRS, which would you put first in the list? Definitely the patient is having accelerated hypertension, and because of that, this could be a PRS or a posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. So the patient is having accelerated hypertension, or you can even call it a hypertensive emergency, because there is an end organ damage, because there is a renal involvement. So definitely there is an acute kidney injury. Patient is having SLE, autoimmune thyroiditis. But actually we are still not happy, because everything is not solved yet. Because again, this patient had bipyramidal affection also. If you look at the CT, when sir was discussing regarding CT, there was definitely a pattern of PRS. But this posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome, just read that again, posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. So the posterior means, you know, the brunt of the attack or the vasogenic edema is in the posterior part. So it is a parieto-occipital region that was affected. And in the non-contrast CT also, we did not have any involvement of the internal capsule, and brainstem also, we were not so confident of the involvement. So why did this bipyramidal affection occur? We definitely need an MRI for better characterization. And for the viewers who need to, who are new to this particular term PRS, I just explained that to you in simple words. See, this is a condition that occurs, just like Sumer sir said, when there is an abrupt shift in blood pressure or an abrupt shoot of blood pressure. Commonly, we see it associated with preeclampsia. Yes, we get common consultations from the obstetrics ward. So whenever there is an abrupt change in blood pressure, which may not exclusively occur with preeclamptic patient, it can also occur with any condition in which there is an abrupt shoot of blood pressure. What happens is that, you know, the normally when there is a blood pressure increase in our brain, definitely there is a cerebral autoregulation. But you should understand that when there is so much of hyperperfusion, the cerebral autoregulation, which is mainly because of the sympathetics, is less developed in the posterior brain regions. So since the posterior brain regions is having less of sympathetic innervation, what happens is that, you know, a rush of or a gush of blood, you know, is likely to produce vasogenic edema in the posterior aspect. That is why it actually causes posterior injury. This is reversible also once you control the blood pressure. So, you know, it's easy to remember this term, posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome, a manifestation of abrupt shoot of blood pressure. Now, for this patient, we scheduled an MRI on an emergency basis itself. But something quite interesting happened. You know, just 1 or 2 hours before the MRI was scheduled, the patient reported an abrupt worsening of vision. And he was saying that he cannot see anything. He just could not see anything. You remember when he actually presented to us, you know, the menace reflex was present. He was at least able to see, but there was a sudden dip in vision. And when we quickly examined, we saw that only perception of light was present in both eyes. Okay, so there was a severe visual loss in both eyes. So we checked the fundus also. The media this time was totally hazy. Even I was also not able to see anything. What I mean is that a totally hazy media, we were not able to see anything through both the fundi. Now, what could have happened? We proceeded with an MRI brain with a contrast with an MRV and with an additional curiosity on what happened to the eye. So let's see this. Sumer sir will take us forward with this case on the MRI findings.
Well, thank you, Rahul, for an excellent discussion here. And let's see the MRI images. As I already mentioned, that CT is not the correct modality to actually characterize the disease further. And MRI would have the advantage of being a multiplanar and a multivariate imaging. We can see and characterize a lot of findings here. And also remember, especially for posterior fossa brainstem, MRI remains the standard of care. The CT is unable to usually pick up the brainstem lesions, which were being suspected in this patient, but we could not pick them up earlier. So let's start seeing the MRI imaging. In front of you, you have two axial T2 weighted MRI images, and you can again see that there is evidence of T2 on a T2 weighted image. T2 weighted image is a fluid sensitive image. We can see hyperintensity in the white matter in the bilateral parieto-occipital region symmetrically, what we suspected earlier also. So we can see that there is some vasogenic edema in the posterior predominance. And then we are reminded of the discussions that we were having earlier, and Rahul was telling us that the posterior circulation is more prone to have changes of press because of that lack of sympathetic innervation and all those things that we were talking about. So again, we are thinking maybe it is fitting more in terms of press. And a beautiful finding that we want to see here is we have to look at the flow void of the superior sagittal sinus. You can see that the flow void is normal. So there is preserved venous flow voids here. So it again reassures us probably that we have kept press as the first DD, and you know, we are on the right track. Let's see the other images in this patient. When we look at the other images in the posterior part, we can see that there is definitely cerebellar atrophy. You can see the foliar predominance. We already saw that. We already suspected that on MRI. And kind of we had, you know, correlated the alcoholic history with it. But an interesting finding now is opening up, which we did not think of before. We can see the brainstem. We can see the medulla. There is hyperintensity in the medulla on a T2 weighted image. There is the areas of edema in the medulla. And not only the medulla, I want you to go backward and look at the, because when you're doing an MRI, we have that ability, we are able to see at the cervical spine level, we can see in the spinal cord also there is hyperintensity. So this is something which we could not pick up on a CT, and actually we cannot pick it up on a CT many times because MRI has, because there is some beam hardening artifact that happens in CT in the posterior fossa, and that limits the evaluation in the brainstem on a CT. This is one of the big advantages that MRI brings into the place. So now we start seeing that there is brainstem involvement, and there was some suspicion there, and we can see that even in the pons area also. Cerebellar atrophy is still seen, but there is something very interesting in these images. I want you to look at the orbits now. When you look at the orbits, you will notice a thin membrane-like structure with which is your retina here, and you can see there is some subretinal fluid. And especially on the right side, you will see that that membrane that you see has a triangular shape. Posteriorly, it seems that appears to attach to the optic disc, and anteriorly, it appears to be limited by the ora serrata. So this is how a typical configuration of retinal detachment looks like. And you can now also notice that on both sides, the optic nerve sheaths, they have some fluid distension in the optic nerve sheaths, and there is bilateral retinal detachment also, which was probably why the, you know, Rahul actually on purpose mentioned a very significant statement that the neurologist could not see, and the, you know, you could not see any, patient could not see anything. That kind of correlates when we say that there is evidence of bilateral retinal detachment also here. But one thing we are not really clear here, and that when we were reporting this case, actually we were not clear, is retinal detachment a part of this spectrum of press, or are we looking at another thing? Because we have so many unrelated things here which we are trying to put together. We had a patient with autoimmune thyroiditis, we saw SLE, we had hypertension, we saw changes of press. But now we also have cerebellar atrophy. We try to link it up to alcoholism. Now we also have retinal detachment. We don't know if we are able to link it up to the disease process that we are seeing, or is it one more isolated thing which we are able to see? But one thing which is pointing that it is part of the spectrum of the disease is bilaterality and a symmetrical involvement that we see here. Something is happening in this patient which is causing symmetrical involvement. We saw symmetric involvement in the bilateral parieto-occipital areas. We saw the brainstem involvement. And now when we look at the sagittal images, something which we suspected on the axial images is further clear. You can see the involvement of medulla is beautifully seen here. And not only the medulla, look at the entire cervical spinal cord. You will see involvement of the spinal cord also. Again, a question arises, can you have brainstem involvement in press? The answer is yes. But can we have spinal press? The answer is again, yes, but we'll have to look at because now we are looking at some things which are unusual, and are we able to fit them all together here becomes the question. So on the MRI, if I try to summarize things so far, we have seen T2 weighted images and with the axial and sagittal plane showing us brainstem involvement, spinal involvement, parieto-occipital involvement. Now you are able to see FLAIR images. FLAIR is a T2 weighted image where we have suppressed the CSF signal. So now, because it is inherently a T2 weighted image, you can see the involvement of pons, and we can actually see it better here on a FLAIR. And again, that bilateral parieto-occipital involvement posteriorly symmetric is again confirmed on a FLAIR image. This is, a typical FLAIR is able to show us that typical vasogenic edema appearance that we can see. And if we try to now look at the orbits of this patient on the T2 and FLAIR images, you will see on FLAIR, we are able to confirm the subretinal fluid, and that fluid is different from what you see in the globe otherwise. So it is not suppressing on FLAIR, and you can see that triangular configuration, which is very typical of retinal detachment, where you have that attachment to the optic disc and ora serrata. And you can again appreciate that we have retinal detachment on the T2 and the FLAIR images. Both of them, we are able to see the retinal detachment. One important image to look for further in this patient will be the diffusion weighted images, and also we would want to see the contrast enhanced images. Now this is a post gadolinium T1 post contrast images, and we do not see any enhancement in the area which we saw abnormal on T2 and FLAIR images. Again, this is expected in press to have such non-enhancing areas, but it is not always there. In press also you may have enhancement, but in this patient we have that typical thing of there's no enhancement on post gadolinium T1 weighted images. And when we look at a FLAIR image on a diffusion weighted image, there is no hyper intensity on the DWI. That tells us that the edema that we were looking at is confirmed, that we are looking at vasogenic edema. We are not looking at infarction, or we are not looking at cytotoxic edema. So because had it been infarction or cytotoxic edema, it would appear hyperintense on diffusion, which we don't see in this patient. Further, helping us to see that, okay, probably we are looking at the same etiology where we had that blood-brain barrier disruption and leaking of fluid and leading to edema. So this is vasogenic edema, again, confirming my diagnosis of press. But before I hand over to Rahul, I would not mind looking at the MR venogram, because that was one of our differentials. And you can see on the MR venogram, you can see the superior sagittal sinus, the lateral sinuses, sigmoid sinuses. They're all beautifully seen. They are actually seen much more beautifully here to tell us that the venous sinus thrombosis is totally ruled out. And now we are at press with brainstem spinal involvement with bilateral retinal detachment. I leave it to Rahul to tell us if they can all put it together here. But these are the things that we are able to see. even when on the susceptibility weighted images, there was no blooming, ruling out the presence of hemorrhages. There's no contrast enhancement, no diffusion restriction. And we saw involvement in the bilateral posterior occipital and the, you know, parieto occipital areas, and the globe shows retinal detachment. We saw all that in the imaging. I think, you know, this is the summary of the imaging findings for you. And we, you know, refer back to the neurologist to put it all together. And are we able to see some unusual things here, or are they?
Yes, sir. You know, like this case is almost like a puzzle. You know, just before the MRI, we had some doubts, you know, why this pyramidal tract was involved. And now you have clearly showed us why, because definitely the brainstem is involved, which can very well explain the pyramidal tract involvement, because it is a diffuse affection, as well as it can, you know, also explain why this patient was drowsy. So this patient was drowsy because the brainstem was involved and the reticular activating system was involved. And again, you know, the curious case of a sudden visual loss that happened to this patient possibly is because the patient developed a retinal detachment. So that also is quite clear. But as again, sir said, you know, a lot of atypicalities in this patient, you know, especially with regards to the brainstem and spinal involvement, which can rarely occur in PRESS, the retinal detachment that occurred in this patient. And above all, this is a male. This all things are happening in a male patient with SLE. So altogether, it's almost like a jigsaw puzzle. It's almost a combination of all rarities in one patient. So what is our final diagnosis now? So this is clearly a case of posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome with a parieto occipital, brainstem and spinal involvement, bilateral retinal detachment, accelerated hypertension, acute kidney injury, SLE, and autoimmune thyroiditis. So that would be our final diagnosis. And for all the viewers, you know, the two main atypicalities of this case, one is retinal detachment occurring in a PRESS, and second is the brainstem and spinal involvement occurring in PRESS. Now, sir was mentioning regarding, you know, in our discussion, we had searched regarding certain references, because whether retinal detachment is a part of this particular disease process, you know, and sir actually forwarded this article also from the American Journal of Neuroradiology. You know, this is again a case report where a retinal detachment can occur in a case of a posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. Now, if you're wondering how it occurs, what happens is that when there is hypertension, the choroidopathy of hypertension is attributed to the vasoconstriction of choroidal arterioles. And this actually leads to a necrosis of the retinal pigment epithelium. And subsequently, there is a serous retinal detachment. But it need not always be serous. It can be an exudative detachment as well. So that is how retinal detachment occurs in PRESS. Now, with you know, this is an interesting case, so we just needed to, you know, just doubly confirm what is happening in the eye. We went forward with the optical coherence tomography, OCT also. And you can beautifully appreciate the retinal detachment in this case. You can clearly see in this picture of OCT that there is a detachment. And here also you can see there is a detachment. So there is a bilateral retinal detachment in this patient, quite obvious on OCT or optical coherence tomography. So we also move forward with a B-mode ultrasound eye. Sumer sir will be enlightening us on this finding.
In orbit, we can, you know, actually use a high frequency ultrasound to look at the orbital findings also, which we can see here. You can see that bright, continuous, membrane-like, you know, smooth, folded membrane. So if we were doing an actual real-time imaging, you will see the movement in that retinal detachment also. And with recruitment of the extraocular muscles, the observed independent excursion of this membrane is called as after movement. This helps us to differentiate from choroidal detachment, which does not demonstrate after movement. So B-scan ultrasound is a good idea to look at, and we can see that membranous detachment here, which confirms the MRI finding. On MRI, we saw that typical V-shaped appearance where we saw the attachment at the optic disc and the ora serrata, confirming again, telling us that they were looking at, you know, retinal detachment. Now, you know, I would like now, you know, if we you know, put things together here, and I'll ask Rahul to, you know, summarize it for us. That, you know, Rahul, so we started with a patient who had you know, autoimmune disease.
Yes, sir.
SLE, and we had
SLE was there. Yes, autoimmune thyroiditis was there.
And then he had hypertensive.
Yeah. So the examination, you know, like one thing is that this is a 34-year-old male who was previously there is no comorbidities, short duration raised ICT drowsiness, and subsequently on evaluation we found that this patient is having an autoimmune disease, in fact two autoimmune diseases, and subsequently this causing an accelerated hypertension, because of which led on to the PRESS or posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. And definitely, you know, a PRESS with rarities, I would like to call it, you know, rather than the usual PRESS. So, and regarding the management of this patient.
Yeah, in between, ruled out the vascular cause also, there was no renal artery stenosis.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Also ruled out pheochromocytoma.
Cytoma. And
you know, listeners to appreciate that how, you know, on each part, the neurologist is working to, you know, rule out things also. All those negative things are equally important.
Yes.
That, you know, pheochromocytoma, there was nothing. So we kind of put it into, you know, fitting the pieces of the puzzle. But it is important to notice and remember that not every piece of the puzzle will fit in, because the cerebellar atrophy, we could
atrophy,
not...
Yeah, exactly, sir. Exactly.
You know, but we had a clue in alcoholism there, so it helps us to be there. But that is a point that I wanted to mention for the undergrads and the postgraduates listening to us today. If you are an undergraduate, examiner would always try to ask you questions which are straightforward, single finding. But when you are a postgraduate or a DM resident appearing for exams, there will be things which will not be able to fit in. That is truth. And so, you know, sometimes when I am as an examiner, I'm taking an exam of radiology residents, I find some of them, they try to fit everything into it. And sometimes there are things which are we are unable to fit into a single disease process. It is possible. Yes. So not everything that you see in real life is an exam.
Yes, correct, sir. Correct, sir.
Okay. So let me now ask Rahul to, you know, how would you treat this patient?
Sir, you know, like in front of us, you know, the main problem as of now, one is, you know, the vision loss, retinal detachment. Should we manage that by surgically or just management of blood pressure alone? Actually, we had a consultation with the ophthalmology department as well. So it was quite rare to them also, but on discussion, we came to a consensus that, you know, we'll first aggressively reduce BP, because we'll first try the conservative line of management, because from the previous case reports also, we saw that, you know, at many a times, control of blood pressure would actually help in reducing this retinal detachment. So what we did was we managed the patient with a strict blood pressure control. And since there was autoimmune thyroiditis also in this patient, we started off with thyroxine supplementation. And this patient was a case of SLE. So in follow-up, we started the patient on immunosuppressants also. And, you know, quite happily, you know, the patient symptomatically was better. And the vision significantly improved, you know, and the patient was able to come walking in the next follow-up visit to the OPD. So currently, you know, this particular patient is in follow-up. So it is a happy patient, happy doctors. So, but it was quite a rare case. You know, I just invite Sumer sir also to say the closing comments on this case.
I think, you know, Rahul, we have, you know, actually looked at a great case. And I think this would form a good learning experience for the residents as well as for sometimes even for consultants also. You know, because things are not always, you know, straightforward, but they require a lot of patience. And I want you to, and I want the residents who are listening to us to appreciate that how patiently we have worked out on it. There's like no genius involved here that, you know, we are looking at it and now suddenly we are telling it. We are always talking to each other. We are always trying to find out what he is thinking. And then we are trying to rule out what features in the imaging are helping us to rule out on some things. But remember that we always have to be humble enough to accept that there will be limitations of each imaging modality. For example, like in this patient, if I had raised on to say that on a CT itself, if I had said that, oh, there's no brainstem involved or nothing, I would have been, I would have to look like a fool when the MRI would come up. So we have to know the limitations of each modality. We know the limitation of CT is in the posterior fossa. And so we could, you know, save ourselves by saying all that in the report initially. And second thing to notice here is that there is a role for a lot of consultations there. You know, although we said, you know, retinal detachment, but the neurologist is not happy with the radiologist saying it. They would always confirm it with an ophthalmologist, with a beam or ultrasound, OCT. It's always like we're trying to confirm a lot of things. And there was an in-between, there was invisible lab which came up with the diagnosis of SLE with those antibodies and all those things coming into place. Otherwise, we would not have thought of autoimmune disease in the beginning of the discussion, but it came in between. And there was a role of Doppler being done for vascular disease. We were looking at the pheochromocytoma marker. So all this time we were looking at why a young man is hypertensive. So we were looking at multiple things, why he had visual symptoms, why pyramidal symptoms, why he was hypertensive. And we are trying to answer those questions. And in between, you know, if you notice, the neurologists were always trying to taper and manage the, think about the management on the side, that how he would manage this patient. And it's a great idea to see that the patient is actually coming back for follow-up and he's doing well. And that is the purpose of the entire discussion. We should, as a doctor, never forget the key here is patient management. Whatever discussions we are doing here is not about our ego. It's not about, you know, being proved wrong sometimes or right sometimes. It is about constantly looking at and solving the puzzle. And you know, if Rahul allows me to give a remark here, and I'll ask him to give one but I feel it's very important to tell to people here is that in a real healthcare system where you're working, which is not a theoretical system, you have to constantly interact with the other people and keep asking questions.
Yes, sir.
Especially for radiology residents, because I see a lot of radiology residents, they like to sit alone and they don't want to talk to others. If you don't talk to the clinical resident, what will happen is you will write something which will be totally out of sync with what is happening. And then you will lose the trust of your, you know, physician colleague. So it is very important to keep asking questions, try answering, and be humble enough that, you know, even if you do not know, it's a good idea to search the literature, like we search the literature in this case to look for, do we have retinal detachment with press or not? And there's no harm in accepting that we did not know initially, but when we kind of worked up, we were able to zero it down. And I think that is the key messages to be taken, and that is how actual workflow would happen in a real hospital also, by asking questions. Keep checking yourself, and if you're not able to answer the questions that the patient is asking, please keep searching for it. There must be answer if the body of the patient is asking a question. Rahul, all to you.
Yes, sir. You know, like this case, in fact, was, as you rightly said, sir, was a great learning experience for all of us also. So, you know, it's just like I would again say is that this is an atypical of an atypical case with so many rarities, you know, in this jigsaw puzzle. So it was nice, you know, to the ultimate thing is that the patient actually got better, and you know, we were able to reach the right diagnosis. And since everybody was involved in the loop, the radiologist, the ophthalmologist, you know, ultimately the patient got benefited. You know, we were able to reach the right diagnosis. So that is how integrated medicine is. It's always a teamwork. So that is what I also want to point out, sir.
And I would like to tell to the listeners that, you know, you can follow us on Dams Daily channel on YouTube for more such videos. We have a series called as Unplugged. You can actually search on this channel and you'll find many, many Unplugged videos on this channel, and you can, you know, build up your understanding of medicine. Our goal, and especially if you're a medical student listening to us today, our goal is to tell you that understanding of the disease process is the key for your exams, not rote learning. Don't go towards rote learning. Enjoy medicine. I wish you all the best. Do write in the comment section if you enjoy these videos. Thank you very much.